What do most people know about the Carboniferous period? For one, it's the time when massive underground coal deposits were formed. But it's also remembered as the Age of Giant Insects. Yet the Carboniferous, or Coal Age, was much more than just a time of towering bugs. It was a period of intense geological activity and an explosion of diverse life forms. In today's episode, we'll explore how coal basins were formed, why insects reached such enormous sizes, and how food chains worked during this strange and fascinating chapter in Earth's history. Subscribe to the Age of Dinosaurs channel to stay updated on our newest videos about the history of life on Earth. Don't forget to like and leave comments to support our team and help grow the community. The Carboniferous period began around 359 million years ago and ended approximately 299 million years ago. Over those 60 million years, life made huge strides. For the first time, animals had fully colonized land. Tetrapods, four-limbed vertebrates, developed five-toed limbs and diversified into distinct groups. Meanwhile, tectonic plate movement continued, slowly pushing the continents together into a single massive landmass known as Pangaea, the supercontinent that would eventually split into all the continents we know today. To the east, a new ocean called Tethys began to form, while in the west, the Ryuk Ocean disappeared as the continents of Gondwana and Laurasia collided. At the start of the Carboniferous, global sea levels were high, and much of the land was submerged under shallow seas. But by the middle of the period, Earth's climate began to change, leading to the formation of a large ice sheet over the southern regions of Gondwana, near the South Pole. One of the most striking features of this time was the Earth's atmosphere. For much of the Carboniferous, oxygen levels were around 35%, significantly higher than today's 21%. Scientists believe this surplus of oxygen was due to the vast amounts of plant matter that didn't decompose. Ancient tree-like plants would die, but instead of breaking down, they would become buried in swampy soils, trapping carbon dioxide and forming thick layers of peat and coal. This odd process happened because fungi and microbes hadn't yet developed the enzymes to break down lignin, a tough component of plant cell walls. These enzymes only started appearing toward the end of the period. During most of the Carboniferous, nearly all of the land surface was blanketed in dense forests. Like in the preceding Devonian period, these forests were primarily composed of massive ferns, horsetails, and club mosses. This was also when gymnosperms, cone-bearing plants like early conifers, cordet, and cycads began to thrive. By the middle of the period, spore-bearing plants were widespread. Since these plants no longer needed water to reproduce, they could spread into drier inland areas, far from oceans and freshwater sources. But life wasn't only exploding on land. The Carboniferous also saw a boom in marine biodiversity. One prime example is a group of single-celled organisms known as fusilinids, a type of foraminifera. These tiny creatures, usually less than a centimeter in size, lived either in the ocean floor or as plankton. Over time, their spiraled, multi-chambered shells accumulated to form thick limestone deposits, many of which are still mined today. Also prominent in Carboniferous seas were colonial creatures known as tabulates and heteractinids. Tabulates were early corals, while heteractinids were once mistaken for sponges. Both are now extinct. Tabulate corals formed colonies that could cover up to 150 square centimeters. Each individual corallite was less than a centimeter across and came in a variety of shapes, tubular, prismatic, or curved, depending on the species. These corals often grew so close together that their colonies resembled tightly packed chains. Heteractinid colonies were made up of delicate hair-like tubes no wider than a millimeter. These calcium-based tubes fused together into larger, complex structures ranging from flat plates to domes with knobby protrusions, Some colonies even had denser, wrinkled layers along their edges. Among mollusks, gastropods, snail-like creatures, and cephalopods such as nautiloids flourished. The ocean floor also hosted bryozoans, brachiopods, and echinoderms like sea urchins, crinoids, sea lilies, and starfish. As for top ocean predators, the Carboniferous marked the rise of cartilaginous fishes, particularly sharks, and a now-extinct group called the bradyodonts. Unfortunately, fossil evidence is scarce due to the cartilage-based skeletons of these animals, but their teeth remain. One shark, Campodus, likely reached up to 43 feet, or 13 meters in length, based on the size of its teeth alone. Bradyodonts were widespread across Europe until the end of the Permian period, and fossils have also been found in North America and Australia. Their broad, flattened teeth were perfect for crushing the shells of mollusks. Their presumed primary food source. Scientists believe these fish had wide, flat bodies similar to modern-day rays. Though extinct now, bradyodonts are considered distant relatives of chimeras, the ghost sharks of today. In freshwater environments, apex predators were often lobe-finned fishes from the rhizodont family. These giants could grow 20 to 23 feet long, 6 to 7 meters, and weigh 2 to 3 tons, making them the largest known freshwater fish in Earth's history. They had elongated bodies that tapered toward the tail, with fins positioned near the rear. Their powerful tail fins gave them speed and agility, ideal for ambushes in swampy waters. Fossils have been found in regions that are now Russia, the US, and the UK. However, these fish weren't the only freshwater predators. Large reptiliomorphs, a transitional group between amphibians and reptiles, also vied for dominance. One of the most impressive was Eogerinus, also known as Eogerinus athaei, or Philidorpidin. Its build and lifestyle likely resembled that of modern crocodiles. This predator could grow up to 15 feet long, 4.5 meters, and weigh over half a ton. With a vertically flattened tail, Eogerinus was a powerful swimmer and likely hunted both fish and amphibians along the shores. Despite its size, Eogerinus still retained many amphibian traits. It couldn't venture far from water, but that didn't stop it from ambushing prey at the water's edge. To date, scientists have identified two distinct species of this genus, one found in Canada, the other in Scotland. These ancient creatures lasted until the end of the Permian period. Of course, not all amphibians of the Carboniferous were giants. Some were actually quite small, like the Brachiosaurus, not to be confused with the much later sauropod dinosaur, Brachiosaurus. These salamander-like creatures rarely exceeded 4 to 6 inches or 10 to 15 centimeters in length. They had wide heads, elongated, flattened bodies, long tails, and short limbs. Their larvae were fully aquatic and breathed through external gills, while adults developed functioning lungs. Toward the end of the Carboniferous, a new group of tetrapods emerged, the lepospondyls. Some paleontologists believe these so-called thin-spined creatures went extinct by the close of the Permian. Others argue they were the ancestors of modern amphibians, or at least the limbless ones. The lepospondyls were a varied bunch, ranging from small insectivores to large aquatic predators. The first group included animals like Sauropleura, also known as Cinchosaurus. These small, newt-like creatures lived in Europe and North America and resembled modern salamanders. The largest of the lepospondyls were diplocaluses, highly unusual creatures with boomerang-shaped heads. Adults grew to about 3 feet or 1 meter long and had wide, flattened bodies that suggest a bottom-dwelling lifestyle. Scientists are still debating the purpose of their distinctive skull shape. The name diplocalus means double fold, referring to the large extensions that protruded from either side of its skull. Some researchers believe these helped it swim by providing horizontal stability in the water. Wind tunnel simulations support this idea, showing the head shape could help keep the skull at the surface. Others think these extensions were a result of sexual dimorphism, helping animals attract mates. Still, others suggest the skull was for defense, but that theory is weakened by fossil evidence. Remains of Diplocallis have been found in the stomach contents and nesting sites of predators, like Dimetrodon. It seems these strange amphibians were often easy prey, especially during droughts, when they'd bury themselves in mud to survive. Among the first fully land-adapted tetrapods of the Carboniferous was pedipedes. These primitive amphibians lived in what is now Scotland during the early Carboniferous. They descended from lobe-finned fish, like Acanthostega, which we discussed in an earlier episode. But unlike their aquatic ancestors, pedipedes had true limbs, proper feet and toes. Interestingly, the nearly complete skeleton of pedipedes was discovered back in 1971, but it was initially misclassified as a fish. It wasn't until 2002 that researchers re-identified it as an early tetrapod. The discovery helped fill a major evolutionary gap between Devonian lobe-finned fish and fully terrestrial vertebrates. The only known specimen was about 3 feet or 1 meter long, considered a medium-sized individual. It had a narrow skull and breathed air using lungs. However, its inner ear structure still suggests it spent a lot of time underwater. A possible relative of pedipedes was Wachiria, a tetrapod that lived in what is now the United States around 340 million years ago. Discovered in 1995, this animal measured about 3 feet long and 16 inches tall, 1 meter by 40 centimeters. It was still quite primitive, retaining the lateral line system used by fish to detect vibrations in water. It had a pointed snout and a smooth, deep skull. Scientists believe Wachiria led a semi-aquatic lifestyle. Its young were fully aquatic, but adults spent much of their time on land, returning to water only to hunt or breed. One of the later Carboniferous tetrapods was Westlothiana, a small predator named after the West Lothian region in Scotland, where its remains were found. This creature was just 8 to 12 inches long, 20 to 30 centimeters, and lived along the shores of freshwater swamps, feeding on smaller animals. What's most intriguing about West Lothiana is that scientists still can't definitively classify it as either an amphibian or a reptile. It appears to be a transitional form, something in between. But the real terror of the Carboniferous wasn't a fish or an amphibian. The dominant predators on land were insects, and they were gigantic. We've talked before about monsters like Arthropleura, the multi-legged giant millipede, and Meganeura, the dragonfly with a wingspan of over 2.5 feet, or 75 centimeters. But the Carboniferous also produced many other bizarre and oversized arthropods. In 1994, paleontologists in Scotland discovered the fossil remains of the largest known scorpion ever to exist, Pulmonoscorpius. Its name literally means breathing scorpion. Most individuals were between 0.5 and 9 inches, 13 to 230 millimeters long, but one fossilized segment suggests some individuals could grow up to 28 inches, or 70 centimeters. Another impressive predator was Megarachne, whose name means giant spider. When it was first described in 1980, scientists thought it was an enormous arachnid. Later analysis, however, revealed it was actually a Eurypterid, a sea scorpion. This ancient arthropod grew up to 20 inches or 50 centimeters long and likely lived both in water and on land. It preyed on invertebrates and early reptiles. Of course, Earth still has some large arthropods today, such as king crabs and horseshoe crabs, which first appeared back in the Devonian. But these modern giants are aquatic. The enormous size of their Carboniferous cousins on land is believed to be linked to the high oxygen levels of that time. Because insects breathe through a system of internal tubes called trachea, the oxygen-rich atmosphere would have allowed their muscles to metabolize more energy, supporting larger body sizes. Some scientists also believe these insects had few natural enemies. birds didn't exist yet, and there were few, if any, predators capable of taking down monsters, like Meganeura. That may explain why they dominated terrestrial ecosystems. This brings us to a fascinating twist in Carboniferous food chains. If we scale up the dietary needs of a modern dragonfly to the size of Meganeura, each individual would require nearly a pound, or 500 grams of meat per day, about the same daily protein intake as an average adult man. But there weren't many herbivorous insects back then. The dominant plants of the time, horsetails, ferns, and club mosses, had tissues that were tough and nutrient poor. Most animals didn't bother eating them, so if Meganeura and its larvae fed on smaller insects, those insects too must have been carnivorous. In other words, the Carboniferous food pyramid was flipped upside down compared to today. It's very likely that giant predatory insects fed not just on other bugs, but also on vulnerable amphibians and the earliest reptiles. Back then, it wasn't frogs eating flies. It was the other way around. Insects were the ones stalking and devouring the ancestors of modern frogs and lizards. As always, we'd like to thank our viewers who stay with us until the very end of each episode. If you're curious to learn more about the origins of different species and the fascinating creatures that once roamed our planet, check out the other videos on the Age of Dinosaurs channel. We also explore the development of humankind and the complex relationship we've always had with the natural world.